Hello everyone, Frank here from Metal Injection, in conjunction with Inferno Festival, with my very special guest, Dmytro, of Ukraine's 1914, a band that especially focuses on the gruesome tales of World War I, and unbeknownst to the members, would find themselves years later living through the tales that they speak of. Dmytro, I really appreciate your time speaking with me today, and you know the whole world is watching and talking about what you guys are currently going through, and I think it's an important really message to speak to somebody from the inside, you know, on this mess and paint a perspective for the metal community. So thank you for being here.
Thank you too. Thanks for inviting.
First, I did want to start there. I mean, the lyrical content of metal tends to lean towards very gruesome events, and you know, in both fiction and nonfiction, but to live through them is a very different scenario. And you know, as we're on the brink of what some are calling World War III, do you find, you know, your message and the parallels in your band and music are more relevant than ever?
Honestly, I don't want to call it World War III. This our war. I don't want to call it World War III. And I don't want to find some parallels with the Great War or, for example, Second World War. So yes, we are banned about, we're focusing on the Great War and actually about war. We're totally about war. But if you talk about this our situation, about our war with the Russian, so it's completely different, total different. So with my bands, with the lyrics, we're singing about history, we're singing about some soldiers' fate, you know, about trenches, about a lot of the mad despair and the wall, this shitty area of war. And for you, maybe for the whole world, it's some kind of storytelling without any backgrounds. Because you are from United States, or you're from Norway, or from European Union, and you just forget all this shitty war and creepy war stuff. You didn't remember nothing with this. We, as the human, as the Ukrainians, as the bands, we live inside this war already 8 years. It's not start 1 month ago. It all started 8 years ago when the Crimea Peninsula, when Russian invades our territory, kill a lot of our soldiers and invade our country. So already we are 8 years at war. And right now we have a huge invasion. With all this shit, with tanks, missiles, with rocket launches, and blah blah blah, a lot of.
And I'm sure that maybe frustrates you, you know, to the idea that it's been 8 years, but the world has only been watching for a month now.
You're right, because the world just watched. That's all. You know, all these 8 years. Those shitty European and American politics just, oh, we are deeply disturbed. Oh, it's sad. Oh, they killed some Ukrainians. We don't give a fuck. No one cares about Ukrainians. When someone killed French people, everyone in Facebook, je suis français, je suis Paris, and other stuff. If someone kills Ukrainian, oh, we didn't count those Slavic bastards, so let's forget about it. So all these 8 years, the world just watching, you know, like a TV show maybe. And just this 1 month, everyone really deeply disturbed. So, but not Ukrainians. We are prepared. All these 8 years, we are preparing. And now we are ready. And now our army fucking awesome killed those Russian bastards, those Russian invaders, and we beat them all in all fronts. So in all areas, we beat them up.
The last few weeks, each country has released propaganda against each other, depicting the extremist communities. You know, like there's you know, NBC and Russia putting out, you know, the content about Azov extremist battalions. And, you know, but as the average citizen of Ukraine, yeah, it sounds like you had foresight that this was gonna go to war. I mean, it seems like a surprise to most people in the world. But, you know, when you were preparing, when the country was preparing, was there an expectation?
We are a small and peaceful country, and we never ever built a huge propaganda machine. We didn't care about it. We don't need it. We are agriculture country, you know? We never been in wars, and we never invite other country. We never took other territory and never killed another people. We just a big agriculture country. That's all, without any bullshit propaganda. So no, we did not start it with this, but Russia did. Again, if we talk about some nationalistic battalion and all this blah 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 media, Western media shit, come on, man. I live here. We all live here, and we all know the situation, you know, from the roots. And yes, maybe in Ukraine, some people used some like swastika or other Nazi bullshit or nationalistic symbols. Yeah, if you talk about Azov, 900 people.
Right. Yeah, it's tiny.
Can you find in your country 900 Nazis? I think yes. Can you find in Germany 900 Nazis? I think yes. In every fucking country, you can find a 900 Nazis. So it's a propaganda or it's some wow fairy tale or what? It's a media boom about in Ukraine, we find a 900 Nazis? Come on, man, it's a bullshit. 200,000 of our army, our Ukrainian army, yeah? And 900 of men with some swastika. Come on. Western world do not know nothing about Ukrainian history. You know, for the typical Western guy, Ukraine is some part of USSR or some part of Russia, the country near the Russia, and we probably speak our language is Russian, something like this. They thought like we are not a separated country or independent country. We are the part of Russia. I heard a lot of stories about it, and I can say one thing, it's bullshit. Because you don't know nothing about Ukrainian history. 100 years, this battle started not 1 month ago, but 100 years ago, in the time of the First World War, when Russian Empire first invaded Ukraine and first invaded Galicia, western part of Ukraine, and my hometown, they invaded with the troops in 1915. And our guys, our soldiers, fought against the Russian empires, and after that they fight against Nazis, Germany soldiers, and Russian soldiers, Bolsheviks and Red Army in the Second World War. And we, our Ukrainian insurgent army, fight against the Russian army 10 years more than when the Second World War finished. Our insurgent army, 10 years plus, fucking kill the Russian invaders. And all this time, we have our language, we have our history, and it's different. It's not a Russian. We are separated. We have a different language. You know, it's the same bullshit, like let's compare maybe Polish and Czech Republic. Oh, they are Slavic, so probably they talk on the same language. But no.
You know, at least here on the West, I could say that it's, you know, we've seen harrowing pictures of Kiev under fire. Mm-hmm. Chernihiv has been completely taken over by Russian soldiers at one point. It's hard to get a sense of where the battles are. And I believe that you're further west in Lviv. Is that right?
Yeah. Western part.
Can you tell us what the average day looks like right now? You know, are you able to go outside and have a sense of normalcy, or is it constant fear of going out?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we are in western part of Ukraine right now, like a backyard of the war, you know. So central Ukraine and eastern Ukraine are totally at war, and mostly our cities on eastern part are devastated, like Kharkiv, Mariupol. They fight with the Kherson, and a lot of cities. They strike Kyiv. They hit them hard, really hard. So there's a real war and real battles. Here in Lviv, we haven't any Russian troops, Russian tanks, or some you know, let's call it troops. But every day they launch it missiles, cruise missiles every day. We have a air raid sirens. So you hear it and you go to the shelter a few times per day, a few times per night, and you don't know where these missiles will hit. So every city in western part of Ukraine, in our part where I'm from, called Galicia, every day suffered from the missiles, from the Russian missiles. They launched it a lot of 15, 16, 17 per one time from Crimea Peninsula, from the Black Sea, from the ships, they launched it. And this cruise missiles hits every city. In one day, maybe in Saturday, it will be our city. In Monday, it can be a Ternopil, you know, in Thursday, it can be some Khmelnytsk, and you don't know where it will hit and when it will hit. So you just hear the sirens and okay, you go to the shelter. So the typical day, our western part of Ukraine, the typical day looks like I'm going to my just daily work. So I'm working in the office. I'm must somehow you know, collected money, because we need money to live and we need money to support our army and our economy, because Ukraine is not too strong economically strong country before the war. but with war, we are totally we're in the deep shit economically. Yes, I understand United States sent to us a lot of supports, really a lot of money, really a lot of weapons. I appreciate it. We all appreciate it. Yes, United countries, not all European Union, but United countries like Great Britain, Baltic countries like France, they send it to us money, supply, weapons. Okay, we appreciate it, but we need to work here to collect money for our economy. So our typical day, you go to your work. After that, you go to volunteering for your army and your country. You it can be anything. You can buy some armored jackets or helmets for army, or knives, or you can buy some food and supply for refugees, or you can do by yourself some different stuff for shelters or anything. Or if you have a car, you can ride to the Polish border and buy some supply and bring it here and just give the food to refugees from the eastern part of Ukraine. And it's actually a typical day in the western part. And all this time you hear the sirens and you go to shelter. In the night you hear the sirens, you go to shelter. So just a typical day.
You say typical, but I hear frightening. I mean, it's like to hear an air raid siren and have to run to a bunker of some sort is not typical, you know?
Yeah, it's not a normal. I'm understanding. Even our toddlers, even you know, a small toddlers here looking at the sky and talk rockets. Everyone here just waiting those fucking Russian rockets.
That's terrifying. And that also, you know, leads to questions of, you know, how would the youngsters of Ukraine be growing up, you know, with that in mind?
I don't know. Actually, I don't know. I think the whole country after all this shit will highly need one big psychotherapist. because a lot of PTSD with the soldiers and with the refugees from the eastern part, you know, 3 weeks you are sitting in the fucking shelter, like not even shelter, like it's in the cellar of the typical house, and you all these 3 weeks under the rocket launch, under the bombing, under the it's nonsense, you know, it's typically PTSD. And I meet these refugees from eastern part, from Kharkiv, from Volnovakha, that's our cities near the front, and they are totally, they devastated like a human. They don't understand nothing. They sitting and just watching in one dot, and that's all. And they do not eat, they do not drink nothing. It's a catastrophe.
Absolutely. I mean, it's one of those things where even if you do make it out alive, you're still psychologically like fucked up from it. You know, I mean, that's there's a lot to that.
And we do not talk about 100 people like this or 300. No, thousands and thousands or maybe millions of people like this, you know?
Right. You know, and you chose to stay in Ukraine to be with your families. And that's such an honorable thing, you know, as you do, thousands are fleeing the country. Do you feel torn by that decision? Was it ever something in your head to leave, or did you, like, you knew you were going to stay?
This is our home, this is our land, and we will stand our ground, you know. How can you leave your home, your parents, your love? I love my Carpathian mountains, I cannot leave it, you know. I love my city, I cannot leave it. Some fucking Russian invaders will walk in here and destroy my city. No, I can't do this. And no one in my bands and all my friends, we all here. And we are preparing. We are learning how to fight. I hate wars. It's not normal. War is a fucking hell. And I want to love. I want to live. I want to travel. I want to travel with my small daughter. I want to visit in Paris, Belgium, United States, drink some beer and playing a lot of gigs. That's what I love and that's what I want. But I can't do this because some fucking madness, mad dictator from Russian Empire started this fucking war. So we're not allowed to live, allowed to love, and allowed, it's not normal.
And, you know, I like that you said that because personally, as I mentioned, I have friends in Ukraine and in Russia, and both parties are absolutely disgusted with Putin's behavior. You know, in something like this, it's easy to lose sight that a dictator is behind this and not, you know, the 90% of a country simply going to work and trying to provide for their kids and whatnot and live their life. But I see a lot of, you know, Ukrainians blast out anger over the entire country, and it's really erupted into a global prejudice. You know, everybody's kind of hating on Russia right now. But how do you personally feel on that? Are you able to, you know, delineate the dictator from the country?
In my opinion, actually, it's not fair. It's not fair to talk that the Russian didn't vote for Putin, they didn't like Putin, and they did not accept Putin. No, they are all involved. I know some guys from Russia, Russian Empire, let's call this shit like this, from Russian Empire, yeah, they do resist to regime. Yes, they resist, and they in the jails, mostly they are anarchists, they are in jails or they in the courts, in the police departments, blah, blah, blah. But honestly, they told me we can't refuse because they took us to the jail or to the police department. And what? And what? You know, if they took you to police department, I understand it's too horrible and it's too shitty, but come on, our city is devastated. They killed thousands and thousands of our people, our children. So is it, can you compare devastated cities and, oh, you will be in the police department and maybe they will beat you one time? Okay. For me, it's not fair, you know?
And, you know, right now, though, Putin has a stronghold over information even that circulates within the country. And, mm-hmm. you know, another iron curtain, keeping his citizens blind, filled with mm-hmm. false propaganda, and essentially jailed in their own country. But if you could put out a message to the people of Russia, what would it be?
Resist, and that's all. That's all. There's no different ways, just resist. Go to the street, took everything what you can, cocktail Molotov, some, I don't know, iron stuff, some knives, some hatchets, took everything and resist. Kill all cops, kill all militaries.
But, you know, U.S. news right now is reporting the talks are finally happening between Zelensky and Putin, and military activity is supposed to drastically reduced. However, full disclosure, we had to postpone this interview twice because of air raids that you're experiencing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, heading into Sedler, has there been any sign of things slowing down for you?
No. No. They actually announced some Russian side, announced some, how it called, they will leave a few areas, few war areas near the Kyiv, near the Chernihiv, and they will took their troops to the Belarus. They announced it, but it's a fake. It's a fucking fake because they just send in troops to the eastern part of Ukraine. So every conversation with Russian politics, every dialogue with Russian politics is a bullshit because they spit on everything and they just don't give a fuck about normal conversation. Some, you know, they just spit it all.
I don't know that either country could possibly prosper out of this, and it's completely fucked up, and there are, you know, losses on both sides. Do you feel that, you know, are you hopeful that Ukraine will flourish again after this?
Honestly, I don't know. I don't know because here right now, we don't know nothing. How it can be, you know, the fucking Russian Empire have the huge atomic weapons in the world. A lot of thousands and thousands of atomic bombs and missiles. So if they wanna launch it, how can we resist? No. If they wanna occupy some Baltic countries, they will do it. If they wanna destroy the Poland with the nuclear weapons, they can do it. And they can do everything. So I don't know. I just don't want to talk about near future because I don't know nothing. We're just sitting here preparing, waiting, and that's all. And I don't know how it will be in a few days, not some 1 month or 1 year forward, or no, just tomorrow. I don't know. Maybe again, IR raid sirens and rocket launch it, and that's all. Bye-bye. So, I don't know.
Well, I mean, you know, we started this talking about how the world is finally paying attention to Ukraine, you know, and what's happening there. And as I said, the world is watching and gathering together to donate and focus on Ukrainian culture like never before. Many mm-hmm. are realizing for the first time, you know, what a dense cultural hub Ukraine is. And, mm-hmm. and that, of course, includes metal bands such as 1914, Ginger, White Ward, and many mm-hmm. others out there. You know, is there, of course, a lot of efforts have gone through. Is there anyone in particular that, you know, you'd like to shout out or think does the best for what you guys need right now?
Everything. I just can talk about one thing because, I don't know, because we are just right now trying to resist. And again, I told you, trying to resist the biggest country in the world and the second biggest army in the world. And we do it well, but we're a small country. How long we will do this? Without any support, when I talk without any support, you must understand that right now, the United States, the Great Britain, the Baltic country, and the mostly European countries send us a lot of support, a lot of, and we appreciate it because it's fucking awesome. And for example, United States gives us javelins and a lot of weapons, and it really helps. But we need more.
I'm sure this might be the furthest thing from your mind, given what's going on. But, you know, living through these current events, are you inspired, you know, musically, artistically, you know, in this experience? And do you think it'll change a new artistic outlet in any sense moving forward?
If we talk about my band, we will continue with our The Great War stuff. And no, we do not think about this war, but we yesterday started again with the rehearsals. First time we started with the rehearsals, and we are preparing a new material with the Ukrainian lyrics. I wanna show our support to all our warriors, to all our fighters, to all our army, and we wanna record a few songs with Ukrainian lyrics like a support. Because I received a lot of message from the front, from our soldiers. Thank you for your music. We listen it at the front, and with your songs, we actually resist, and actually we killed those bastards. Thank you for your music. So that's why we decided to make a few Ukrainian songs.
And I think that's the most perfect thing I've heard. Like, I mean, to honor and cherish your heritage like that, and that's important, especially in a time like now, you know.
But no, this war not inspired. Every day, every hour, every minute, you just read the news, how many people died there, or they killed one family, or they killed 10 families, or they kill the children again, or they bomb in hospital, and every time, and it's not inspired.
Well, Dmytro, again, I can't thank you enough for being with me here today. You know, I wish you nothing but the best, and can only hope that we get to meet in person in a much better world, a much better time, a much better circumstance.
I hope so.
You know, and all the love and peace and best wishes to you, man.